इंट्रोडक्शन चाहिए। यस
यस यस
रेडी।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, वी आर लाइव नाउ, वी कैन गो अहेड।
यस, गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी, गुड इवनिंग मिस्टर प्रेसिडेंट, गुड इवनिंग प्रसाद पराग, गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर प्रकाश सिगेदार एंड गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर संजय दुर्जड़। कोविड 19 पैंडेमिक इज अ बिग चैलेंज टू द एंटायर पब्लिक एंड टू ऑल इन दिस सेंचुरी, एंड इट्स ग्रेट दैट एमओए हैज डन such a wonderful program on MOA Day. And therefore, to begin my induction, I call upon Mr. President to introduce, and then eventually I will ask Dr. Parag to speak upon. So, Dr. Shinde, to give a welcome note, please.
Good evening, dear colleagues. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
On the behalf of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, I welcome you all. I wish you all safe and healthy life in this COVID crisis. As you all are aware, we are celebrating 38th MOA Foundation Week. This is our sixth webinar in the series. Win over second wave is our theme for this year. And today we are discussing our experience in COVID situation. Dr. Prakash Sigetar will be talking on surgery in COVID era, while Dr. Sanjay Durjad will be talking on challenges in running a COVID hospital. I am very delighted today as my team has chosen these COVID protocols as the topic for discussion, which has affected every individual, every aspect of life and human existence. Now, considering the exponential rise in the COVID cases in our country, I believe that actual number of cases is much higher because of many of cases remain unnoticed due to lack of testing facilities. And in our daily practice, we come across positive cases or even asymptomatic carriers. Because of this, we are still in dilemma regarding choosing the patient and right treatment modality to be safe on either side. So it is very essential to form a protocol for OPD, IPD practice, as well as precaution to taken in the operating room to avoid the mishap. In this session, we will address the safety measures and operation theater protocols. My best wishes to today's webinar. I hand over the mic to Dr. Parag Sanchetti for his remarks and for further proceeding. Jai Hind, Jai Maharashtra, Jai Bhoy.
Please.
Thank you, Ajit Shinde sir, our dynamic president, our Vice President Dr. Sanjay Durzat, speaker for today, coordinator Dr. Prakash Sigedar, past President Dr. Deshpande sir from Ahmednagar, and editor-in-chief of Ortho TV, who is live streaming this program, Dr. Ashok Sham. A very good evening to all of you, and it's indeed a very, very well chosen and an apt topic for the current pandemic what we are going through. Last wave, the first wave was, but now what has happened is second wave is more stronger, more patients are there, and we are always in a dilemma, you know, as a surgeon, whether to operate this non-COVID patient, not to operate, what test to do, RAT test, RT-PCR, whether to take the patient without a test, if he's asymptomatic, all these questions are there, and I'm sure Dr. Prakash will bring them out very well. Dr. Sanjay is also going to speak on a topic which is equally important in today's day and time, the challenges of a hospital. The staff is not used to run a COVID ward. They are scared, they are apprehensive. you know, and all of them are really under stress. And as a director, as an administrator, as an owner, what are the dilemmas in your mind? I'm sure Dr. Sanjay will bring it out very well in his talk. And I'm very eager to hear that, because I'm sure we all will learn from these two topics. And for me especially, they are very, very important, because I am having these dilemmas all the time, because we have a COVID ward and we are operating non-COVID patients. So I'm really eagerly looking forward to this talk. I want to thank both the speakers for their valuable time and for preparing for this talk. And all the best for your talk. And I look forward to hearing it. Thank you, Dr. Shinde sir, for really making this a memorable week. In spite of the various stresses we have, the various problems, all the talks have been very interesting, very useful. And Ashok tells me we are getting many hits. And I'm sure this program today will have more than 1,000 hits in the next 24 hours. Thank you, Deshpande sir, for being there as a big, big pillar. And the program you did with your classmate was very memorable. He spoke so.
Thank you, Dr. Parag. Current COVID pandemic underlines the importance of mindful utilization of the resources that we have. The resources are in the form of
human resources. Over to Dr. Deshpande, sir.
Yeah.
And thank you, Ashok, for live streaming this. We are very, very obliged to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Parag. Current COVID pandemic underlines the importance of available resources with us, whether it is the human resources, financial resources, or asset-wise, our hospitals, our beds, everything. Preserving resources and manpower is of paramount importance. And as a surgeon, as Parag rightly pointed out, we are always in dilemma whether to conduct OPD, whether to render our services, whether to operate a particular patient or not to operate a particular patient. Without taking much of your time and without acting as a shield between these two speakers, I would also like to share my experiences on this. Probably the task given to me is because I am a sufferer of COVID. If it is said that I am a corona warrior. And see, the lockdown was imposed in the month of March. Then March, April, May, and June, we all kept quiet. But in the month of July, we, as an orthopedic surgeon, rather wanted to render our services to the society at large. And thereby, we also started getting patients, the trauma, the joint replacements, and everything. And I, as a surgeon, probably became anxious and little bit negligent about my own health and got infected. And I tell you, I myself is a showcase of all the complications that can happen in a person. Few were COVID, few were because of the treatments. My lymphocyte count had dropped down to 1%, because of which the absolute lymphocyte count was just 100%. And those lymphocytes, they are soldiers for the battle. And I had very few soldiers to fight the battle. And then after my lymphocyte count dropped down to 1%, I had a DVT. Then I had upper extremity paralysis. On my right side, because of all those IV fluids, I had some necrosis, for which I had to undergo 3 surgeries. And nonetheless, because of steroid, I started having glaucomas. And I came out everything. So the point to be underlined is one should not be negligent, number one. Number two, we should use our resources in a very mindful way, at hospital level, as well as at personal level. So with this note, how to perform the surgeries, how to prevent the infection occurring from the surgeries to ourselves, spreading itself to the patient, and from fellow colleagues getting infected. I think Dr. Prakash Shigedar will enlighten us about surgeries in COVID scenario. And later on, I would request Dr. Sanjay Dhurzad to share his experiences how to run a COVID center. Sanjay, I really had seen all your posts about running a COVID center. I'll talk to you about that after Dr. Prakash's lecture. So Prakash, it is over to you now. And please explain us, enlighten us, all the things that you have observed in carrying out the surgeries.
Thank you. Prakash.
Before that, let me have the privilege to introduce our speaker, Dr. Prakash Sikidar, a very dynamic orthopedic surgeon coming from a relatively rural area, part of the Maharashtra. He belongs to Jalna and is there practicing since last 25 years. As we all know that he is the immediate past secretary of MOA and he has done tremendous job as a secretary for our organization. He was also the organizing co-organizing secretary for the upcoming IOCON 2021. And he has done a lot of work on IMA platform as well. He was the past president, past secretary of IMA Jalna. And he is advisor to the Rural Orthopedic Committee of IOA as well. So spreading IOA fundamentals and IOA principles to the most rural area of the country, he has been taken up that challenge and he has been handed over that responsibility. And I hope he is doing well on that front as well. He is the past president of RSS Jal Kalyan Samiti in Jalna and doing his social activity as well on that particular front. And he's author of 10 books in local languages for public education. And apart from that, he has done a lot of work and he has earned a lot of laurels and awards during his tenure as IMA president of Jalna and also as secretary of MOA. And we all know that MOA has been awarded the best chapter award by IOA in 2018 at Kolkata. And it was because of his leadership as a secretary that MO has been awarded at that level. So I welcome Dr. Sikidar and I request him to go ahead with this presentation. So can you unmute?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Sanjay, for your kind words. Respected President, sir, respected past President, Dr. V.N. Deshpande, sir, Dr. Parag Sanchiti, sir, my teacher and guide, Dr. Mrs. Mangala Borkar, madam, Dr. Ashok Sham, all the past presidents of MOA, all the past and present office bearers of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association and members of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association and all joined ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I am thankful to our president, Dr. Shinde sir, for giving me this opportunity to present my views on surgery in the COVID era. As you know that we are as it is rightly said, it is a nightmare for all the surgeons because of the COVID situation and now in the second wave, the task has become more difficult because of the number of cases increasing and number of complications also and number of staff and our close relatives getting infected. It is becoming day by day very difficult to do the surgical work. So Dr. Sanjay has introduced me already. Thank you very much, Sanjay. The background is that although COVID-19 is not a primarily surgical disease, it has significantly affected the surgical practice in multiple ways. A number of organizations have released recommendations and guidelines for addressing the COVID-19 pandemic. Organizations focusing on concern particular relevance to the surgeons are many and they have given the guidelines for surgery in this COVID pandemic period. Why so much of worry about surgical work in this pandemic? Because COVID-19 is a highly infectious disease and it is a professional hazard because most of the doctors are getting infected. And as on today, more than 1,000 doctors have sacrificed their lives because of this COVID across the country. And this is a dangerous both to the patient as well as to the surgeon and healthcare workers who are working in the ward and hospital. It is more dangerous than HIV and tuberculosis. It affects almost all the organs and parts of the body. And multi-organ failure is the cause of death in this case. And the more funny part is that 80% of the cases are asymptomatic. So whatever patients coming to us for surgery or for the treatment, most of them may be asymptomatic carrier. And that is the most part we have to worry about. Then in current scenario, cases are increasing day by day. The count of India per day is more than 3.5 lakhs per day, and in Maharashtra it is more than 50,000 per day. Second wave is in full swing. Doing surgical work in such scenario is really challenging job, and only emergency cases should be done as the protocol. And wherever you want to have an elective case, you have to take utmost precautions for doing. And RT-PCR test is must before any surgery, because without any test, if you do the surgery, it is harmful as well as to the patient also. You are taking a huge risk by operating the even symptomatic patient without doing the test in this scenario. So there is a big dilemma, as Parag sir has said and Deshpande sir has said, to be or not to be, whether to go for operation, whether to not go for operation, what are the protocols for doing the surgery in this pandemic, what are the guidelines. There are many guidelines from many organizations, and most of the time surgeon gets confused on what to do. Then the standard operating protocols must be followed while during the operations, and it is very difficult to have such following the standard operating protocols, especially in the small setups, especially in the rural areas where lack of resources are there, lack of funds are there for this thing, and it is very difficult to operate in Sina, especially in the rural setups and individual setups. Those who are having individual setups, it is very difficult to do. Testing before surgery is very also important, and most of the times patients are not willing, most of the times kits are not available, but the testing is very important. Without testing, you should not go for surgery. Elective versus emergency is an also very big dilemma. Emergency cases, one has to operate, whether it is a positive, negative, by taking all the precautions, whatever. But in case of elective surgeries, if at all possible, we should postpone the surgery as far as possible. And it is really a nightmare for a surgeon, especially orthopedic surgeons and mini surgeons, to do operation in the surgery. And because of all these protocols and the personal PPE kits, etc., the cost of surgery also goes high. There also, we are facing a lot of problems, especially in the individual setups or in the rural areas. And in the big setups also, the cost of surgery goes many folds, and the patients are not happy with this. So the objectives of this today's talk are to know about the risk in doing surgical work in COVID-19 era, to take utmost precautions while doing surgeries if you are doing, to use a personal protection equipments and other safety measures to their maximum. Infrastructure for the surgical work should be at its best to operate in this, and to safeguard the surgeons and healthcare workers doing the surgical work, and to preserve them for fighting the battle in the future. So literature review, there are many articles, studies in the Western world and in India also about as well on the safety of the surgeon and healthcare worker during surgical work, and the impact of COVID-19 on the surgical work in India. We can see one article on impact of COVID-19 pandemic on surgical work practice. There is again one article on COVID-19 in operating room, evolving measures to evolving the safety profiles protocols, and there is again one article on response and operation room preparations for the COVID-19 outbreaks and surgery in the COVID-19 patients operative directive. So there are many papers and in India and in abroad guiding us about the how to go ahead with the surgical work. The impact on surgical work, there is a huge impact on the surgical work because of the COVID-19, and it is widespread, ranging from the workforce and staff issues as we come across day to day. There is a procedural prioritization, whether to go for it or not to go for, whether it is necessary to do such surgery, or viral transmission risk intraoperatively is more, especially in the orthopedic cases where we are dealing, and there is a aerosol generation, the risk of getting infected is more. Chances of perioperative changes to perioperative practice and ways of working alongside the impact on the surgical education and training. These are the impacts of COVID-19 on surgical work. So this is a pictorial diagram showing the impact on the surgical work, like cancellation of the scheduled surgery, shortage of the blood components is there, shift of the surgeons to the other area, because in the government institute and in many institute, all the departmental is are posted for the COVID duty. So there is a huge lack of surgical experts in their department, limited visiting times is there, and post-operative surgical care, COVID surgical pathway, and COVID-19 dedicated operation theater setup, setting up and coda is very costly, as well as it is very difficult in this situation. And what is the triage? It is very important to select a case. The sorting out and the classification of the patients or casualties to determine the priority of the need of surgery and proper place for the treatment is very important in this scenario. During infectious disease outbreaks, triage is particularly important to separate patients likely to be infected with the pathogen of concern. So to which patient do the priority is very important. So selection of the patient for surgery is of utmost importance. This is the pictorial diagram of triage. When it is emergency, there is no choice. We have to go ahead with whatever proper precautions. But if you are giving choice, selective, or it is elective procedure, then we have to think of how much risk patient is having, how much time we can wait, and accordingly, ASA classification, also anesthesia, how much anesthesia risk is there. And by calculating all the risk, we should select the patient for surgery meticulously, especially in this COVID era. It is very important all unknown or suspected COVID-19 positive patients requiring surgical intervention must be treated as positive unless proven otherwise in order to minimize the infection spread. So we should be always suspicious. Even if a symptomatic patient is there, he has not symptoms, but we should not go without any test or without any evaluation preoperative for the surgery in this era. So CoRTP is important. It is important for surgical specialists to set up a date, up-to-date and latest information concerning the safety measures while conducting the surgeries. It is very important to update your knowledge day-to-day. The evolution of the literature should be closely followed such that the best practices are instituted and upgraded every time to safeguard ourselves and our staff and hospital also. Those standard operating procedures, as I said, they are very important at every stage, whether it is a case selection, whether it is a preoperative workup, whether it is intraoperative, postoperative and rehabilitation. At every time, standard operating protocols or procedures must be followed, must be put on the wall. So, and our staff should be asked to follow all the protocols meticulously, especially in this era, to not to have infection. So various guidelines are there. Initially, when the COVID pandemic started, there were no guidelines from any association, and we were very afraid of doing the surgery. Even though the cases were less, but fear was more. But now cases are more, but we have guidelines from our organizations, WHO, etc. And now we can do the work with following the guidelines given by our parent organizations. Like many organizations are giving, Indian Orthopedic Association, Maharashtra Orthopedic Association also has formulated guidelines for surgical work last year. It is very important and mandatory to follow the guidelines of the WHO and other organizations for the safe surgical practice in COVID era. Then these are the 5 rules for the elective surgery. If you want to go for a surgery elective, you have to follow the 5. Test asymptomatic patients before elective surgery with the knowledge of sensitivity and availability of the RT-PCR at your institute. So RT-PCR is, do not use CT chest as a screening method except in certain types of surgery as a thoracic surgery. Do not rely on the antibody test for screening and implementation of the infection control measures. Reduce the number of operating theater staff, operating room staff and entering and exiting in the operation theater so that infection is less. And be sure that healthcare workers have an appropriate and optimum PP protection during operations. These are the very important 5 rules for the, and these are the key points while going for the surgery. All suspected or infected patients must be managed with the maximum attention. All personnel in contact with the patient must wear PPP. Transfers must be protected. Infected patient must be moved as little as possible through the hospital. Transfer routes must be precisely planned and it should be kept as short as possible. The COVID operating area should be dedicated and possibly separate area. The COVID operating room must be dedicated and close as possible to the entrance of the theater block. Disposable material should be used, should be preferred. Minimal material should be used for each intervention. Transport personnel should be the same from transport origin to the destination. Even after surgery, patient should be reached the ward by the same persons. Once the patient has entered in the operation, OT door must be closed. Operators, surgeon, anesthetists, nurses, technicians should enter the operation room in a timely manner to minimize exposure to the infected patient. Personnel involved in the intervention should not leave the operation room during the procedure. High OR air exchange cycles are recommended, 25 exchanges per hour. Clinical documentation must be done outside the operation theater. That means any writing of the notes or anything that must be done outside the operation theater. At the end of each intervention, all possible material must be disposed of and all surface and electromedical devices accurately cleaned and disinfected. PPE must be removed and disposed out of outside the operation room, dedicated doffing areas, ensuring the virus is not transmitted to the healthcare worker. Operation room and surrounding donning and doffing areas must be sanitized as possible, as soon as possible after each procedure. After each procedure, all involved personnel, whether possible, should get shower. Recovery phase after the surgery must be in the operation room before transfer of the patient to the ward and ICU. Anesthesia and COVID-19. Surgery should be done in a regional anesthesia as far as possible. If general anesthesia is needed, avoid mass ventilation. If intubation is needed, do as far as possible rapid sequence intubation. Use workstation as far as possible and extubate the patient in a deep plane anesthesia. And while intubating and extubating the patient, the people in the operation theater should leave the operation theater except the anesthetist and person who is assisting him for intubation. Then HIV and Corona is more dangerous than HIV. It is highly infectious, needs much more precautions and safety measures, and chances of transmission in operation room are more than HIV because it is through the nasopharyngeal or oral route than getting infection with Corona is very common. Diabetes and Corona, it mimics with the diabetics in affecting almost all the body parts from head to toes. It affects almost each and every organ. Multi-organ failure is the cause. Blood sugar levels increase alarmingly high in COVID patients. It is noted that diabetes is also induced by the COVID in the COVID patient recently, and there are many studies showing that diabetes has been diagnosed after the COVID infection to many of the patients. Tuberculosis and Corona, Corona is highly infectious, needs more safety measures, personal protection equipments, etc. Active cases of both illness are very dangerous in spreading it, but still Corona, it is a pandemic now, it is more dangerous. Then other comorbidities like COPD and other respiratory issues, age above the 60 years, obesity, cancer, immunocompromised patient, all these should be taken care of or thought of before taking any patient for surgery, especially in this particular COVID pandemic. It is an occupational hazard. COVID-19 is an occupational hazard to the surgeon as well as to the healthcare workers in the operating room. It affects both surgeon as well as healthcare workers. Anesthetists are also in the danger zone. So whosoever is in the operating theater room for a longer period is in the danger zone for getting the infection. So personally, protection equipments, they should be used to each and every person entering into the operation theater, and fullest possible protection should be taken with all the standard personal protection equipment kits, for every person in the operation room. Then operation theater simulation or operation theater procedures should be done, or preparation should be done very well in advance. The entry and out exit should be limited, and people in the operation theater room should also be limited. Whatever is necessary for operation, they should be allowed. Otherwise, they should not be allowed in the operation theater. And signages are very important. We should put everywhere labels like put on 95, keep mask, donning area, doffing area, enter into the OT. And all the signages are very important as far as the preventing the infection in the surgical room. Preparations in the operation theater room must be planned, and minimum use of the staff with the maximum possible utilization of the staff and with the minimum equipments, we should get the surgery done so that chances of spreading infection are less. And care to be taken at every stage, we have to take the utmost care, preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative. Like as I said, the team should be less surgeon, anesthetist, etc. Machine and equipment should be checked and sanitized properly. Prepare the drugs in advance. COVID coordinators to lead the effort. Transfer of the patient should be in the full PPE kit, etc. And in intraoperative also, full PPE, all personnel to stay outside OR during intubation. Airway secured by both the experienced anesthetists. Only experienced anesthetists should do the intubation so that there is no chances of infection. And it should be done in the deep plane so that nobody gets other infection. So post-operative also, dedicated transport ventilator, hand over to the isolation and ICU team, appropriate degrowning of the use the protection equipments, activate ESS and contact tracing form, etc. And shower before removing and going to resuming the normal activities very must, especially in this area. So how to manage how to be safe for the surgeries, elective surgeries as far as possible should be postponed. Standard infection control practices should be in the practice in the place. Take precautions when performing aerosol generation procedure. As I said, drilling or joint replacement surgery, they should be done with utmost precautions. Operating rooms should be allocated and signs posted on the door to minimize the staff exposure. If no general anesthesia, patient should continue to wear the surgical mask. If general anesthesia, place the HEPA filter between the VIPs of the breathing circuit and the patient mask. Endotracheal tube or laryngeal mask airway. If available, use the closed suction system during airway suctioning. So, and what is the time or timing of the surgery following the SARS-CoV infection? If one has infection, the elective surgery should be delayed for more greater than or equal to 7 weeks, more than 7 weeks following the SARS-CoV infection to reduce the risk of post-operative mortality and pulmonary complications. In addition, patients who are still symptomatic for more than 7 weeks after SARS-CoV-2 infection may benefit from the further delay until their symptoms resolve. So each and every case is separate. We have to take the call depending upon the case. So postpone unless the essential for the patient outcome. So these are the recommendations for surgeries. Prepare OT for COVID-19 cases. Educate the surgeons. Develop preparedness plan for providing essential operation. Operations during the pandemic, decrease exposure of the health staff, particularly surgeons, develop dedicated COVID-19 OT and prepare the repurposing OT to support the critical care patients. So in updated, does every patient require airborne infection isolation rooms? No. Updated CDC interim IPC demands says that there is no need for such a special room, only in cases where we are doing the aerosol generating procedures and all. So here we have to take the precautions and beds should be at least 1 meter apart and we have to take the necessary care in special care in such cases. So in conclusion, what we can say that the surgical staff needs to keep abreast of the latest literature concerning safety measures to be taken during the surgical procedures. Review articles can go some distance in helping in the educational process. This knowledge must evolve as a new information comes to the light. Infection or death of the sub-specialized staff must be minimized to preserve the ability to face the surgical emergencies and associated activity that will continue to occur or perhaps increase during the mass casualty or we don't know how this pandemic is going to behave. So we have to preserve our staff and our surgeons and doctors as far as possible. The decision about the resuming elective surgery should be updated according to the incidence of COVID-19 cases in and their hospitalization. The symptom questionnaire plus the RT-PCR test are important tools for screening the preoperative patients and possibly the symptoms questionnaire will be more directive in the future. The sensitivity of the RT-PCR is about 66 to 80% and positive prediction rate value ranges from 47.3 to 84. In the low pandemic area. So it depends upon the area also where the number of cases are there. Thus, it should be reconsidered by the authorities according to the institutional and local setting before defined as a screening method on its own. Routine CT scan has at no added value particularly for the patients. So instituting precise, well-established plans to perform the undeferrable surgical procedures or emergency surgeries on the COVID-19 patients is mandatory. Hospital must prepare specific internal protocols and arrange adequate training of the involved personnel helping for the surgery. A word of caution, it is all these theoretical and it is on paper, but in spite of knowing all these guidelines and measures to be taken for the surgical, it is very practically difficult and impossible to follow these norms in the individual and the rural setups, particularly in our India, because infrastructure is very less, resources are very not available, and the affordability of the patient is also a problem. So we have to take calculated risk in doing surgical work. We should follow the norms to the best possible way and try to prevent ourselves and our staff from getting infected from the coronavirus. That is in our hand in current scenario. So take home message from this my talk is doing surgical work in COVID era is very challenging job and it is really a nightmare for any surgeon. Risk of infection and death of healthcare workers, including surgeon, is more. Bias for the selection of cases is very important, whether to go for operation, not for how can we postpone, that is very important. Risk-benefit ratio should be considered, how much is the risk, how much is the benefit, and depending upon that, selection of the cases must be done. Personal protection equipments must be used for each and every person entering into the operation theater and handling the patients in COVID-19 wards and COVID-19 operation theaters, and utmost care must be taken while doing surgical work. Thank you very much. Thank you for patience listening.
Thank you, Prakash. It was a great talk indeed, very informative. And we all orthopedic surgeons are dealing with emergency cases. And therefore, it was very important for us to know how to operate, whether not to operate, and what precautions we need to take. And I think I'll take question and answers from the audience. And then we shall proceed to Sanjay Dulzars. I take this opportunity to welcome Mangala Burkar ma'am. She is a professor of medicine. And we would also like to get few queries answered from her side as a physician. And so first question,
I think we will finish
Sanjay Dulzars talk and then we will take
lecture and then we will have a question to both of them.
Yeah.
Then that is also fine. That is also fine. We can have combined. We can have combined question and answer session.
Yes.
Welcome, Dr. Patil.
We should know what additional thing Sanjay is going to tell us.
Yes.
And then we will ask both of them simultaneously.
Sure.
Okay, President, as you say. So I will call upon Dr. Prakash Shigedar again to introduce our speaker, Dr. Sanjay Dulzars. Sanjay is a very astute social worker and he is doing a great job. He is carrying out social responsibility by conducting and by running a COVID center. I call upon Prakash to introduce Dr. Sanjay Dulzars.
I have a privilege and honor to introduce our Vice President, Dr. Sanjay Dulzars. He is a highly active member of our association and our fraternity. He practices in Nashik over last 18 years. Apart from being successful medical practitioner, he is also highly skilled and trained, talented orthopedic surgeon. His contribution to the society is immense, especially for the COVID patients during his pandemic. His Sudarshan Hospital is the first private hospital to have voluntarily converted into dedicated COVID hospital. Undoubtedly, his experience and knowledge of running the COVID hospital from very beginning till today will surely put some light on the challenges faced while running a COVID hospital. He has a big list of contributions towards the medical field, colleagues, and the society at large. But his contributions in the pandemic is significant, and first dedicated private hospital, as I said, instrumental work in reducing the cost of treatment of COVID. First individual to officially announce the package for home isolation, successfully conquered over COVID after being infected. He himself got infected, as you know, and he successfully overcome over that. And he helped the COVID patients to recover fast. And I have also experienced, whosoever calls from Nashik, I give Dr. Sanjay Dulzars' name and Sanjay helped them without any delay and with all dedication. He conducted the online motivational programs and for the masses during the lockdown and overstays. He helped organize MOA activity last year and this year also. He is a project chairman along with me for MOA Day activities. I welcome Dr. Sanjay Dulzars for his talk on challenges in the running COVID hospital and his experience over the last 1 year. Over to you, Dr. Sanjay Dulzars.
Thank you, Sigadar sir. Thank you very much. I also extend my thank you to our President, Dr. Ajit Shinde sir, Dr. Parag Sanchiti sir, Dr. Deshpande sir, Burkar ma'am, and Ashok Sham. So I thank you all. I especially thank the MOA for giving me the opportunity to share my experience as a owner of a private hospital dedicated for COVID. So thank you, and I am very much obliged to MOA for giving me this opportunity and the whole executive body of MOA. So we'll start with the presentation. My topic for the presentation is challenges of in running a COVID hospital, and my personal experience from last almost 1 year. We started our hospital as a COVID hospital in June first week, and it's almost now 11 months that we have been working in COVID, and we have got all sorts of experiences, good, bad, and to be or not to be. And this is an opportunity to put forth my views and my experiences. And my request to everybody is that this is a personal experience, and this is a sharing of my personal life, whatever I have experienced from last 1 year. And I request everybody on this platform, as well as the people who are watching on live on Facebook and YouTube channel, that this is the reality. This is the actual picture. This is the scenario behind the curtains, because there are a lot of myths and this thing about hospitals and doctors. And especially a non-medical person or a layman thinks that doctors are earning a lot and they have got opportunity to make money in this particular scenario. But I would like to tell you, everybody, that this is not that easy. This is not that simple. And this is definitely, this is life-threatening as well. I mean, you have to be very at a high risk, and any business or any profession with more the risk, you get more the benefit. Although we get money, but we have put in a lot of efforts. Everybody, every doctor who runs a COVID hospital definitely has put in a lot of efforts. He has worked against all odds and has faced many challenges. These are few of my experiences, my challenges. And to categorize all the challenges, I would like to put it like, there are challenges on various fronts. There are personal challenges. There are challenges in the system, what we are operating in. There are financial related challenges. And nowadays we are facing challenges about the resources. And there are a lot of challenges on social aspect as well, because we are working for the society. We are working for each and every individual of our own city and the state and the country at large, and the world at large, basically. So we are attached to the society, and society is looking upon us as responsible professionals and doctors and medical service providers. And it is our prime responsibility to save their lives and give them proper treatment in all possible aspects. So just to share my experiences, the basic challenge at personal level is the risk of getting infected. Previous to COVID, the risk of getting infected was minimal. I mean, people working in tuberculosis or swine flu or communicable diseases, in that case, in those scenarios, the chances of infection was very minimal, or with minimal of protective devices, you could protect yourself. But in case of COVID, yes, there's a lot of risk involved in it. And we have seen and we have experienced a lot of doctors who have been infected, and many of them have lost their lives. So it's definitely the biggest risk and biggest challenge, what I think, that the moment you decide to start a COVID hospital or give your services to COVID patients, the first thing which will come to your mind is, yes, will I be infected with that? And that physician or that doctor or that health worker has to overcome this challenge at the first instance. Yes, he knows that he might get infected. In spite of knowing that he's going to get infected, still he works, still he jumps in, still he provides his services. That is the biggest thing what a doctor can do. And that's why doctors are termed next to God, especially in such kind of pandemics. So knowing that you're going to get infected, still going into it and providing your services is the biggest challenge. Secondly, not only you would get infected, but the risk of spreading it to your family members and to your loved ones and to people around you is another big challenge, because sometimes you go into a guilt that because of me, my parents, my children, my wife, my family members might get infected. And if it happens so, a thing might creep into your mind that it's because of me, what has happened. And if anything wrong happens or is some mishap happens, it's very obvious that the doctor or that health worker might go into a sense of guilt. And that also has to be overcome. And there are a lot of training going on, counseling going on to overcome all these challenges, basically. And you have to be mentally very strong, very strong. And that takes a lot of toll out of you. At times, you have to be isolated from your family. Initially, when it was considered as a stigma, or there was a lot of fear in the society, especially in the first wave, I myself had to isolate myself from my family just because of the fear that they might get infected because of me. And that's how, like, 4 to 5 months I was staying away from them. Maybe a weekly visit at home with all the precautions was my routine thing. And that is the biggest sacrifice a person can do. And it is none less than a soldier or a protector. And that's how healthcare workers are dedicating their life to the society, to the patients, to this pandemic and people affecting for COVID. So getting isolated from your family is something which is very difficult, very challenging. Even after following strict hygienic protocols to prevent the spread, you might still spread it to your near ones, to the people whom you meet. So it becomes very difficult. You cannot go out anywhere. You cannot share anything with your family or your friends. It's very difficult for anybody to allow you to come to their homes and all. So that is considered, initially it was considered as a stigma. And we have seen a lot of examples where a doctor was not allowed to enter into the society. The colony people, they just treated him as untouchables, or that was a very difficult times for all the doctors. We have seen so many incidences of that sort. And apart from that, when you make a mental preparation of working in a COVID and to work in COVID wards, COVID hospitals with the PPE kit on, not only for the doctors, for all the health workers, it's very difficult to work with the PPE kit on. And with all those masks and face shields and all those gadgets, gloves and all, your visibility, your working efficiency and your speed of working is also dropped down. And there are so many patients around, the hospital is almost full. You're working to the highest capacity with minimal of resources and you're all the time occupied with minimum of flexibility for your working. That is a big challenge for on personal grounds. There are challenges with the system, either with the government policies or policies of the local body. Yes. And we have to comply to each and every small little thing. And there has been ever-changing government policies and protocols right from the beginning. Initially, we have seen that when the patient was detected in a hospital, the hospital was sealed for almost 2 to 3 weeks. And then they have been changing the protocols from isolation of 2 weeks to 1 week. And then we have now stopped isolation or separation of the individuals or the hospitals. So the government is also learning and the local authorities are also learning. Even the research teams are learning from the past experiences. And it is hardly 1 year that we have been facing this virus, this illness. So this is the biggest challenge. You have to always, I mean, my experience is that every week there is a new protocol, new policies coming from the local authorities, that's a corporation, or maybe the government is giving guidelines on a very regular basis. So you have to adapt to the requirements and the policies of the government. And you have to have a person dedicated for the compliances to the local bodies. There is a system wherein we have a COVID bed reservation system by the central government. It's a website and we have to upload all the data connected to that patient, right from his admissions, his clinical condition, his progress, his treatment, and whatever happens to that patient has to be uploaded twice in a day on that website. And this is the bed reservation system. You have to have a dedicated person for that. And all the data has to be uploaded and up to date on that particular system, which was not there earlier for any of the diseases. But this is the new challenge for all the hospitals to maintain the data and to upload it on the central website. daily reporting of admissions, discharge, audit, the bills getting audited, and the debts has to be on regular basis, on daily basis, and everything has to be informed to the local authorities. Initially, it was only limited to the corporation, but now debts has to be informed to the local police stations and other authorities also. So as the scenario changes, or as the situation changes, the policies also changes, and the protocol also changes. So you have to be updated, and you have to keep updated for yourself and to the local body as well. There are certain rules and policies of a particular area or a particular district that you have to reserve beds for corporation areas. And there is an area-wise distribution, either the patient belongs to a corporation area from the outside the corporation, or within the district and outside the district. Everything has to be informed in detail to the local authorities. So these compliances takes a rough toll, and a separate system has to be established for all the compliances. Then the MPCB or the BMW compliances, and we have to follow protocols regarding the packing of the BMW or the wastages in black bags, and you have to repack in another this thing. You have to sanitize all the waste as well, and the rates at which we pay for the disposable of the waste is tremendously high. It goes in lakhs, and it has added to the burden, the financial burden of the hospital. Complying to various complaints to the corporation or the FDA for the police stations by either the patients or the relatives or from the people in the surrounding area or your neighbors. So whatever the slightest complaint is lodged against you, you are supposed to be answerable to that. And that is also a very stressful thing. At one end, you have to take care of the patient, you have to treat them. Another end, you have to manage their family members. And the third end, that you have to manage the whole system and replying to all the complaints and compliances of to the police station and other authorities. So definitely it's a challenge in this pandemic, which was not that much earlier. And also there is a auditor which is nominated at each hospital. All the bills has to be audited. It has to be according to the government guidelines and protocols. And nowadays with so many incidences which has happened in the country or in our vicinity, a lot of fire incidences has happened, and a lot of people have lost their lives. So now fire audits have become very stringent, and you have to follow all the protocols and all the safety measures regarding fire and entry and exit, and all those norms which were there earlier have been made more stringent now because of the experiences in last few days. Building audits are being made right now. It is in progress. And even now, the oxygen pipeline audits, which were not heard of initially or before this COVID, now all these audits and all these inspections has to be done. And we have to periodically send the audited reports to either the collector office or to the corporation authorities. As I said, that people have a wrong notion about financial gains to the doctors in this pandemic. And a lot of people think that doctors are minting money. Yes, but if you look at the sacrifices, if you look at the risk involved, if you look at the challenges which are there in front of all the doctors or the hospital owners, it's comparatively, these gains are very minimal. These gains are very minimal. And if you happen to take that much of risk and risking your life and getting money in return, so I think that money is worth it. So financial challenges are this, that there's a capping on the rates, hospital rates. We have rates assigned for general beds, for oxygen beds, and for ventilator beds. You cannot charge anything excess of that. Whatever your expenses might be, you have to manage all your expenses through those capped rates. There is a compulsory auditing of hospital bills as well as the pharmacy, that's the medical bill and lab bills, and all the sort of detection tests or diagnostic tests. All the rates has been capped. The HRCT rate has been fixed to 2,500. The detection rate has also been governed by the government. The hospital bills are audited. So there is no free hand for the amount of billing. And that is the biggest challenge, because your income source has been limited and it's been minimized. So people think that hospital charges a lot, but it's not the true case. The purchase of disposables are the additional factors in COVID, especially the purchase of PPE kits, the masks, face shields, and all the protective gadgets for your own self, for your hospital staff, or for the relatives and all. Sanitizer has been used like tap water, and all these expenses have added to the expenses of the hospital, which was not there earlier. Higher cost of hospital equipments and instruments, especially in this particular pandemic, because instruments are not available, they're not been manufactured to that extent. The demand has gone up, and even the transport system is also not functioning to the maximum potential. So lack of availability of the equipments and the instruments have shot up the prices. Even after paying the amount, you're not sure of getting the instruments. Thirdly, the higher cost of consumables like oxygen, medicines, and all other things which are required in managing a hospital or running a hospital. The oxygen tank, the Dura tank, which we used to purchase at 4,000, now it is almost up to 15,000 or 16,000. The rates have gone up 4 times. Medicines also, whatever it is asked for, we have to pay, because we don't have any options. Initially, our pharmacist used to order for the medicines and used to get some site for payment of maybe 30 days, 45 days or 60 days. But now the scenario is that you have to pay 100% advance. And only then you are assured of getting those drugs to your pharmacy. So this is the biggest challenge. You have to pay first. You have to place orders first. And only then you have to you can get the medicine. My personal experience is that almost 2 to 3 weeks back, when remdesivir was falling short, I had placed an order of 1,000 vials my own self. I paid the whole amount in advance. But unfortunately, after 2 days, there was a havoc, and there was this local authority, the FDA and the collector office, they had taken charge of the distribution of remdesivir. And the whole money was blocked with the company. I did not get the injections as well. And now slowly the thing has been channelized. Now I've started getting those assignments and those injections to my pharmacy. So even the oxygen is very difficult to get. There's a lot of shortage of oxygen. We have to give advance payments to the oxygen supplying company or the plants or the industries. We have to give a certain amount as advances, as deposits, considering whatever your oxygen requirement is. So money is required to run a hospital, and it is tremendously high. Higher salaries to the staff with additional securities, either you give them a cover, a medical claim cover, or some sort of security or assurance they need in case they get infected. What's going to happen to them? Who is going to treat, or who is going to spend money for the treatment? And in case of any mishap, what's going to happen? So this is a big challenge for all the hospital owners and the doctors especially. For me, I have assured them COVID bonus apart from the salary. And I've insured them with a medical claim policy of almost 5 lakhs. So that's how I can get staff for working in my hospital. Higher professional fees for the doctors as well and the consultants. Initially, what it was almost 2 to 3 times. And higher cost of BMW charges, as I told you, that we pay according to the weights. Every kg we have to give money. And now the bill, which was initially in few thousands, now it is into few lakhs. So that is how and much the expenses have been shot up. 100% advance payments for purchase of various products, especially all the products. I mean, whether it is electronic gadgets, your monitors, your ventilators, or your medicines, you have to pay 100% in advance. And that also, you're not assured of getting the items in time. So this is the scenario, and it's really difficult to work and manage a hospital in such a scarce situations. Challenges of resources, as you all know that there is a shortage of all the possible resources. Everything is short. There is a shortage of beds. There is a shortage of skilled manpower. And because initially, there are a lot of COVID hospitals coming up in every city. And to get skilled staff to work in all the extended hospitals, extended beds, so it is not possible. At the most, you can catch up some partially skilled staff and train them and ask them to work, and making them follow the SOPs and the protocols is the only way to get manpower. Even the staff which is there with you, they are being overworked because the hospitals are running full. There is a lot of burden on them, and not getting enough of staff and managing with the available staff with a full capacity hospital will definitely it will overburden the staff. And it so happens that the staff, after a few days of working, a few months of working, will ask for a break. And we do have to give them some break. So that is the challenge. Equipments and instruments not available. Whatever you price, you pay for the prices, still then you don't get those equipments. I personally have placed order for a few monitors. And instead of paying 100% advance, 15 days ago, I have still not received the monitors. So that is the scenario right now. And you have to pay, but you are not guaranteed of receiving the resources and instruments. There is no challenge and there is no capping to the cost of all those equipments. Any equipment for that matter. Initially, what we saw, we started with from last year, the cost of face shields, the thermal guns, the face masks, or the PPE kit. They were charged so heavily. Now, those costs have come down, but the cost of other equipments have gone up, especially the electronic gadgets, the monitors, ventilators, MyPEP machines, the prices have gone up. And there is no control over the pricing of any of the equipments. There is only capping of hospital rates, but there is no capping on other rates. That is the reality, actually. Shortage of medicines, especially remdesivir. I don't want to talk much on the availability of remdesivir or the efficacy and the use of remdesivir. But surely the reality is that there is shortage of medicine. Even other medicines, the antibodies what we use, or the low molecular weight heparins, and the blood thinners and the steroids what we use. There is definitely a shortage, and we have to pay at a higher price. And whatever price the company demands, we have to pay. Definitely, there is a shortage of oxygen, and work has been going on at all the possible levels to ensure a proper supply of oxygen. But this is a natural resource, so it has to be restored at the earliest. You may get away with not administering or not providing a drug to a particular patient, but you cannot get away without providing oxygen to a patient. If he requires, you have to give him oxygen. So it's very difficult for people or for the patients to convince them that we don't have oxygen or we have a shortage of oxygen supply. And they expect the hospital to ensure a proper supply of oxygen. But from last few days, we counsel the relatives that this is a scenario. We are trying at our level. You also have to support us because this is a testing time for everybody. If you help us, we will also help you. And this is how we have been able to manage this oxygen crisis. Even then, we have to get a consent from the relatives that, yes, they are assuring us certain extra oxygen supply. That's how we have been managing this crisis. There is unavailability of maintenance service agencies. The companies, they don't give proper service. They don't have people who can enter into the COVID ward and repair either electrical repairs, or plumbing repairs, or even the repairs and maintenance of the monitors or ventilators in case of any breakdowns. So it's very difficult to get things set right in this situation. And there is a compulsory supply of food to the patients. It has been made compulsory. And this has also added to the financial burden of the hospital. And The other things which are more challenging, what I feel, is that on social grounds, the patient, I mean, the relative is not allowed to stay with the patient. They are not allowed to enter the ward. So the 100% responsibility lies on the hospital authorities and hospital staff. So every now and then we have to go and we have to ask the patient, we have to attend the patient. And the more the staff goes to attend the patient, the more is the risk of getting infected. So it's a double-edged sword. We have to look after the patient as well as we have to ensure that the staff is also safe. So that is one of the most difficult challenges. We don't have anybody to support. And every time we have a problem with the patient, we have to inform the relatives, we have to call them up, we have to counsel them, we have to ask them, we have to get consent for a particular thing. And then only then we can go ahead. So it is a challenging for all the doctors and healthcare workers. Risk to staff and their family members, after that the duty is over, they go home. Even they have their families, even they have their parents and their close ones. So that responsibility also lies on us. So that has to be addressed very well. Risk to the neighbors, the trespassers. If you have a hospital in a common premises like a commercial complex, or you are next to residential area. I personally have experienced resistance from my neighbor people. Initially, it was so scaring that having a COVID hospital next to my premises was considered as very highly risky. So in those times, we have fought and we have stood there and we have come out successful. But now in this second wave, this resistance is not that much high. And as I told you, from the residents or the business owners nearby your hospital will definitely resist you to start with the COVID hospital. There are a lot of antisocial elements working in the society against hospitals, against the doctors, because they think that doctors mint money out of COVID. They think that doctors are, and the hospitals are, churning a lot of money out from the people. And they think that they are the true social workers or true corona warriors. And they are so-called social activists or so-called self-proclaimed social activities. So we have an experience in Nasik that there are a few people who consider themselves as heroes and social workers. They go to the hospital, they inquire about the bills, they pressurize the hospital authorities. And they think that by reducing the amount of money or reducing the bills, they've done a great job. But that is not so. We have to work under this such kind of pressures. They go live on Facebook, they go live, and they have all the medias around. And it's very difficult and it's very stressful to work in such kind of scenario. So this is one of the major challenges, pressure from the local authorities as well as from the politicians or bureaucrats or socially proclaimed people. They also call up for providing beds, for giving discounts, for leaving the money. Expectations of discounting the bills, especially after deaths. And people have that mentality that once we lose the patient, we should not pay the hospital, which is very, very wrong. And it's very challenging. You have to have a special skill to convince the patient's relatives that, yes, we have worked hard, we have spent so much, and but unfortunately, we cannot get proper results. And taking money from such kind of people, I mean, the patients who have succumbed to the illness, is really a tough job. You have to be very balanced in asking for money, in leaving some part of the money, part of the bill, convincing the patient, taking them into confidence and showing them the reality is really challenging. And you have to be really skilled at that. You have to have a team of counselors, you have to have a team of assistants and doctors who can talk to the relatives very often. Difference in approach while admissions and while discharge is tremendous. And you can say it is the two extremes. The day the patient is admitted, the behavior of the relatives is so very humble and so very kind. And you think that, oh, we are God for them, or they consider you as God, and they're going to do anything and everything for you. But on the day of discharge, or the day something happens, their behavior is absolutely 180 degrees ulta, you can say. You don't expect, and especially my experience is that only the close ones, I mean the people whom you know, they trouble you a lot. I've got good experience as well as I've got certain bad experience about people and relatives. And especially all this happens because I feel that there is a weakness in the medical fraternity as an association, because we are not united. That is my personal experience. And just because we have been divided and we don't stand as a community, we don't stand as a unity. People take disadvantage of this situation, and they pressurize us, and they do whatever they feel like. So these are a few of these challenges which I felt should share with you all, because this is the reality, this is the true picture behind the curtains, behind the scene, and what people think is not right. But despite all the challenges, we have to continue to fight Corona, and we have to continue to fight the situation in this pandemic, and we have to find a solution. We have to all these things. We have to win the battle of the second wave, which is our very theme of this MOAD activity and MOAD week. So I thank you everybody, and thanks for your patient listening. And I hope I have made some certain things very clear. If you have any doubts, any questions, you can go ahead for question answers.
Thank you, Sanjay. It was really stunning experience to hear you to run a hospital and in such different and difficult challenges. I call upon question and answers, and I'm sure you all have a lot of question and answers, questions in your mind. Answers, of course, we expect from Dr. Prakash Shigedar and Dr. Sanjay Dursar. Shinde, sir.
First of all, hats to Dr. Hats off to Sanjay Dursar. Really, it is a difficult task to maintain the staff, to retain the staff, to take the bills, and to provide all services. Really, it is difficult. Now you tell how you manage to retain the staff, that you are told you are doing insurance, you are paying some higher salary, or you are giving bonus. But also there are so many other hospitals are coming, and what are the challenge for you to maintain the staff? Whether your all staff is there, or there is some reduction, or you have to, they are going and coming. What is the problem?
I'm very proud to say that the staff which was there with me on day one, 11 months ago, everybody is there with me right now also. First of all, before starting the COVID hospital, I had discussed with them, and I had taken their permission, and I asked them whether we should go and provide services for COVID patients. And it was only because they said yes, I jumped into it. And they knew that there was a risk involved, and definitely anything can happen. And but I said, ki, this is a chance for us. Either we do it and we get the benefit in long terms, not in terms of finances, but as a brand, as a doctor, and as a community hospital owner. So that was the biggest takeaway which will be there for us. And that's how I motivated them. And I assured them of salaries, insurances, and I gave them bonus after the first wave, which I had promised them. But believe me, they did not work for money. They did not work for money.
Very true.
Yeah. They were committed. They were committed. And they worked like anything. I mean, there are... few 5 to 6 boys with me who stay here. They work 24 hours a day, and they're totally dedicated. I don't have to look into any of the matters now. Everything has been set right. All the protocols have been set. And I have given them all the authorities to for admissions, for discharges, for bill settlements, and for making available all the resources, even the oxygen supplies and other supplies. Everything has been handed over to them. And now I just come and sit. And whatever, if at all I go for rounds, it's just a social rounds. And everything is managed by them. The crux is that putting confidence in them, putting responsibility on their shoulders, and asking them to pull the cart. So they are pulling the cart, I'm just sitting. It is the
great teamwork, Sanjay. Great teamwork. You have proved a great leader.
Yeah, it is exceptional. Otherwise,
See, in our hospital, we run a 250-bedded hospital, and 60 out of 250 are non-COVID. Today, we have 307 admissions. And the issue with staff is how to retain them. For retaining them, the famous sentence is used in our hospital is, hey, yuddha hai. Apan sainikani jar palun jayala lagla, tar hi kasa chalel. Ani ladhaivar gelavar, char don ghav ikade tikade padnarach. Kadhi hat tutnar, kadhi pay tutnar, kadhi tumcha jeev pan jau shakto. Of course, as Sanjay rightly said, incentives and motivation. Incentive really didn't work much. What works is motivation. And it is dedication and the bond amongst yourself, the insurance, everything. And amongst all these, Sanjay, the most important part is housekeeping part of it. And the housekeeping part is the crux of any hospital. If your housekeeping staff doesn't come, you can manage without a nurse. You can manage without an RMO. You can manage without a consultant at times. But without housekeeping staff, you cannot manage.
Absolutely. Yes, and we as a hospital owner also have to take the responsibility if whatever happens to them. Yes, yes. I am responsible. I am there. Don't worry. Whatever medicines, whatever admission, I mean, treatment you need, I am there. I'll give you.
And absolutely.
Second question I want to ask. Once you have started COVID hospital, whether your routine practice is remain at ease or people are afraid to get admit in your hospital and you have left the idea of routine, our trauma or orthopedic surgery practice and you are devoted for corona patient.
Obviously, people don't want to come to a COVID hospital and I also cannot admit them and treat them or operate them because my hospital is located on a single floor. And there is very difficult, it is very difficult to segregate either a green zone, a gray zone, or red zone. And I have only one ICU, common ICU. If the patient has to be admitted, he has to be admitted next to a COVID hospital, COVID patient. I've got two operation theaters, but they are very close by. So it's very difficult to segregate COVID and non-COVID area. So that's why I've decided to convert everything into COVID.
Dedicated.
In between, where for a few months, I started the non-COVID work also. But since March 1st week, when the wave picked up.
Second wave.
Yeah, second wave. So then I again started with non-COVID work. And people who demanded me as a surgeon, then I gave them the option. You can get admitted anywhere, any hospital you want. And you can request them to ask me to come and get operated from me. So that's how I have kept in touch with my patients. I go and operate there. But the major advantage...
Other hospital owners are allowing you to come there or they are also afraid that we should not touch Sanjay as he is the source
treating
of...
you as untouchable.
why should that? We should allow that untouchable man in our institute.
Initially that was the thought, but later on, what I do that if I have to go to other hospitals or anywhere for that matter, first, early morning, I do all that work. When I start from home, fresh, and I do all the work from outside. Once Shinde I come sir, to the hospital, I don't go anywhere else.
Shinde sir, with your permission, I would like to add something to that.
Yes, sir.
During first wave,
how you are managing? He has told, now I am almost a COVID man. So you are telling that you are doing both. How you are managing?
Basically, the difference is ours is a private limited hospital. It's a corporate hospital. I am one of the directors and co-owners. During first wave, there was a fear in coming to our hospital. Patient didn't come to our hospital. I lost few of my patients who were my regular patients. But once the phobia and the fear of COVID went away from public's mind, they started coming. And to bring them back, what we did is we isolated the floors. We isolated COVID floors, non-COVID floors. COVID lift, non-COVID lift. COVID entrance, non-COVID entrance. COVID OPDs, non-COVID OPDs. COVID staff, non-COVID staff. We could do that because that's a little big or a medium-sized hospital. Medium-sized hospital. And once upon a time, we were doing a lot of orthopedic surgeries, but now with another wave, second wave again, we hardly have any bed left for non-COVID patients. I have a question with your permission, President. I want to ask to two people, to Dr. Mangala Borkar and to Dr. Prakash Shigedar. I'll take first, since Dr. Prakash Shigedar is busy, I'll ask Dr. Mangala Borkar.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Fitness in COVID as such is one issue. And second issue is increased in coagulopathies and yes. Our surgeries around pelvis, around hip, around lower extremities. They yes. call for either a fat embolism or deep vein thrombosis.
Yes.
So and during surgery for 24 hours, we don't advise heparinization. We need to stop even a short acting heparins for that. So what do you suggest? What is your advice to we surgeons as a physician?
So low molecular weight heparin, where it would be indicated, we should give.
During COVID after patients, 6 hours of surgery and before 6 hours of surgery, we yes. usually want to withheld with it.
That is okay.
Yeah.
That is okay, sir.
Dr. Prakash, I have a question for you. I operate upon a patient in a window period because after doing RT-PCR and rapid antigen test, we take him up for surgery. But after doing a case, he turns positive after 3-4 days. How you address that issue?
This is a very common scenario. And initially, it was a big hammock. Once we operate the patient and it comes positive, then tracing and testing up everybody and closing the hospital for 10-15 days, like Sanjay said. But now the norms have been changed. Even after testing, the patient can become positive. And we can treat accordingly, or at minimum, those who are come in the contact, we can get their RT-PCR done, or if the symptoms are there, we can isolate them. So at present, this is not a very big issue as it was initially. So, and it is usually going to happen because we don't know who is going to be positive, who is going, and the specificity and sensitivity of the test are also not 100%. So even if RT-PCR is negative, we cannot say that patient is not having an infection. So
I asked Mr. President how he addresses this issue. He also has got a very big hospital and a very high volume, very high volume of orthopedic cases.
Now, I am going to ask the Prakash same thing. Prakash, I am having a patient, 32 years male, came to my hospital with a fractured spine and incomplete paraplegia. Patient was admitted privately in a, just like what quoted by Deshpande sir, where all sort of patients are there. There was orthopedic, there was COVID, everything was there. And at there, he was negative. Antigen test was negative, and when she came to our hospital, I planned for surgery, everything, and day when I was going to post him, in the morning, his test came positive. Then ultimately, I postponed the surgery, but he was not ready to leave the hospital. No, you have to operate me. How you are doing? Because, and what has happened, the oxygen percentage become 88%. Now, and I have experienced that if I operate such a patient, they go in hypoxia and lot of problems, and it is very difficult for us to manage. As told by the Sanjay, it is difficult to get the bills and everything. It is a different story. Then somehow I convinced him and I shifted in another COVID hospital. There he is now. Now he doesn't require any oxygen supply, supplementary oxygen and ventilator. Now he is out of ICU. He is out of without oxygen. And mostly 14 days or 16-17 days are passed. And now he is phoning me. I want to be there because he has given some idea. No, okay, this paraplegia is going to recover. You decompress, you fix me. And what should I do? When I should ask him to come? And what preoperative things I should do to operate him?
So now we have to first evaluate the patient, whether it is a condition as it was there, paralysis or paraplegia is there. That means you have to evaluate whether it is emergency as on today or not. If patient is recovering with your treatment and we can postpone the surgery, it is better to postpone for at least 6 weeks. And then if possible, you can do. And if patient is not improving, otherwise also after 15-20 days, we know that in spinal surgery, the results are unpredictable. Even if you operate at this stage, you cannot guarantee the recovery as it was there on the first day. So it is a win-win situation. We have to calculate the risk versus benefit ratio and take the decisions accordingly, because each individual patient is separate. No two patients are alike, no two symptoms are alike. So you have to take the decision on the individual basis and taking into the consideration risks and benefits for both patient as well as to the surgeon. But it is advised that we should not operate for at least 6 to 7 weeks after the COVID SARS positive is there.
How sensitive is D-dimer as to take up the patient for surgery? How sensitive?
Madam,
it would be very useful, sir. D-dimer is very sensitive.
And what is the cutoff level? What is the cutoff level where we should operate and where we should not operate? Is there any cutoff level?
Okay. I'm not aware regarding surgery. But if it is raised, naturally we give low molecular weight heparin, and then you have to see before performing surgery how many days he has been receiving. Then you can do the APTT and see how much elevated that is, and accordingly you can decide.
Anybody else would like to throw light upon
now,
this?
Now I want to ask question to again Sanjay. Now you are running the hospital where definitely there are patients who are only on oxygen, patients are in ICU. So we heard cytokine storm, we heard remdesivir, we heard tolizumab. So what is your experience when you are giving tolizumab, when you are giving remdesivir, and in which position or which day they are really beneficial, or when steroids are beneficial, only at that storm level or initial period? This is my queries, and whether you are tried methylene blue, whether there is any role of methylene blue.
So may I answer this?
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
In a stable patient, there won't be any problem. But if the person's oxygen levels start dropping, so we say less than 93 or less, or if the D-dimer starts rising, CRP, LDH would be relatively non-specific. But if the D-dimer starts rising and the oxygen levels start dropping, so originally they were 97 and they have dropped by more than 3, or they were 95 and they are going below 93, or a 3 minutes walk test. No, your cases may not be able to walk. They may be having fractures, trauma, whatever. But some kind of an exercise and their oxygen is dropping. So that is the time and person is getting fever. So in the beginning, he has fever. That fever subsides and again he starts getting fever. So these are the indicators, particularly the oxygen starts dropping. And you have to give basically low molecular weight heparin and steroids. They are the life-saving drugs. Remdesivir can reduce the hospital stay. And naturally, it is an antiviral if given at this time. But it is not life-saving. Tocilizumab is quite risky, actually. Nowadays, we don't use it almost. because a lot of infections, fungal infections and other problems occur. And it is not shown to be a lifesaver. So the two life-saving drugs are, one is steroids, the other is low molecular weight heparin, and of course, oxygen. These are the three which are the real lifesavers. And they have to be given when you find that the patient is not responding, or in particularly 5 to 7 days after the illness starts, the oxygen starts dropping, or again fever comes up. Fever which had subsided, again he starts getting fever. And D-dimer starts rising. These are the red flags.
Okay.
I want to know, okay, when you are using remdesivir and when you are using tocilizumab, and whether you have any experience of methylene blue.
Sir, remdesivir is used at this time only. Means if the oxygen starts dropping.
Madam, and what I heard is hospitalized, it should not be used after 7 days, and tocilizumab should be used after 7 days. So, sir, actually, the person who are running the ICU, what is his experience, what he is saying when he is using these drugs?
Sir, nowadays, these drugs are not advised, particularly tocilizumab. If it is given very late, plasma therapy, tocilizumab, they can create problems. So,
Madam, daily I issue minimum 20 pounds for remdesivir and tocilizumab.
Remdesivir,
this gives, means sir, some doctors,
it is
the given, doctors are prescribing.
See, government guidelines are slightly different, sir. What private persons do, I cannot comment upon. Government guidelines, ICMR guidelines, I am talking about those.
Yeah, all right, madam,
I don't know about private guidelines.
Because nowadays in private hospital also, so many remdesivir is prescribed and patient asks whether it is available or not. Nowadays, we tell them it is in the hands of collector and everything is
taken by
them. True. Prior to that, they always phone me, sir, see that, use your influence, whether I am getting or this or not.
We'll take Dr. Sanjay Durzar's take on this question, and then we'll conclude. Sanjay, your take on this question, please.
Okay. What we used to follow in the first wave as well, and now in the second wave, we used to categorize the patient as mild, moderate, and severe. So in the first wave, it was like CT scan score, severity score of 8 and less was considered as mild. 9 to 15 was moderate, and above 50 was severe. But in the second wave, now this criteria has changed. People with scores of 8, 9 or 10, sending them home as a mild case is very risky. So the criteria of labeling a patient as mild case is score up to 5. And anything above 5 is slightly risky, where the saturation starts dropping when the score reaches up to 8 or 10 also. So that is how we categorize the patient, first thing. Secondly, all the mild cases, we send them home with oral medications, with favipiravir and oral steroids, oral anticoagulants, and multivitamins. But the patient, when he notices his saturation level is started dropping, usually we counsel the patient that if your saturation level is 95 and above, you don't have to worry. Whatever, if you have fever also, or if you have cough or throat pain or any other symptoms, but your saturation is 95 and above, you don't have to worry. If it drops to 94, be alert. And if it comes to 93, 92, 91, just come and get admitted. That is the stage where he needs actual admission. And that is the stage where we have to install, I mean, we have to give remdesivir. And even the anticoagulants, I mean, the low molecular weight heparins, and the steroid also has to be started at this particular stage when the saturation is 94, 93, 92 and things like that. If he does not respond to remdesivir and he lands up into cytokine storm, that is the stage we give tocilizumab and plasma. If tocilizumab is not available, some substitutes are available. Right now we use basalizumab, which is available right now with us. But in spite of doing all these things or protocolizing everything, still the mortality rate is very high in the second wave. Patients are not responding to remdesivir. They're not responding to tocilizumab or whatever the protocols has been given by the ICMR and the governments. So we fail to understand why It is not responding. Obviously, the reason is that the virus has doubly mutated. But I think something else has to be tried. We don't have any experience about methylene blue. We have not used so far. But we are we have given few patients a dose of streptokinase just for thrombolysis, because school of thought is that there is a coagulation or thrombosis within the pulmonary arteries, pulmonary capillaries. In case we succeed in achieving thrombolysis of the pulmonary capillaries, we have a chance of improving the oxygen saturation. But it's too early to comment on that. Hardly 2 weeks ago, we have made this protocol. Maybe it will help. Madam, your opinion about it?
At least in the previous wave, streptokinase was not shown to be useful. Only low molecular weight heparin or heparin, the whole heparin in serious cases. So the only two drugs, sir, which are accepted to be lifesavers are low molecular weight heparin and steroids, of course, oxygen. These are the three. They have to be started at the right time, as you rightly said, when the oxygen saturation starts dropping. So don't rely so much on the CT scan, but D-dimer is very useful and reliable. But especially whatever the reports, if the oxygen starts dropping, that is the indication you should immediately start these drugs. If you delay, then they are of doubtful value. Afterwards, you don't know whether they'll work or not.
Yeah. And apart from
that, a major problem is our patients come very late. That is the major issue why people die. Majority of them, in spite of comorbidities, if they come early enough to the hospital and treatment is started properly and early, chance of survival is very high. But mostly they come late when the full storm has taken over. That time, all this remdesivir and all, they are of no use.
Right.
And already so much thrombosis must have occurred. So nothing works actually.
Hey, Sanjay, last question I want to ask you. As you know, as you told that cytokine storms when happens, it is just because of the overactivity of the macrophages or antibody reaction. And it is ultimately causing this storm. So what I read or heard, in such a situation as our response of antibodies is over, you should not use the plasma. That has to be again balanced. In young patients, it should not be used. If at all, it has to be used in early days or in elderly old patient where the antibodies are insufficient. Whether you are categorized like that and how you deal this plasma issue?
Initially, when there were no drugs, in June when we started, there was hardly any talk about remdesivir, there was hardly any use of tocilizumab. We did not have a physician even. I had to manage the whole scenario, and it was only through the ICMR guidelines that we used to follow. And my personal experience, leaving all these things aside, madam, I have used fresh frozen plasma in the very initial stages, initial days, and I had tremendous good results with FFP.
Okay. FFP.
FFP, yeah.
Okay.
We used to give 4 FFP on day 1 and 2 daily for next 5 to 7 days. Without remdesivir, without any antiviral, without tocilizumab, we had patients surviving. And even old patients used to survive. That time, hardly CT scans were also done. So, there was no CT scan. We used to monitor the patient with X-rays. And FFP had given a very good results. But when the physicians came in, they were slightly skeptical about use of FFP because they said that...
Yeah, because we use it actually when clotting is deficient.
Yeah.
I mean, it would counter the...
I don't know how how it worked, but it did work. It did work.
Yeah.
I've got evidence, X-ray evidence also of that. Secondly, apart from... low molecular weight heparin and steroids. The role of all other medicines are doubtful and it is controversial. So, does remdesivir work or does any other medicine works or no? There are different schools of thoughts everywhere and it is controversial. Still, there is no definitive treatment. It is all trial and error. It is less than a year that we have been starting using all these drugs. Excellent. So whatever resources we have at hand, we have to use it. Not going into the details whether it is definitely useful or not. We have to keep on trying. As I told you that we have started using streptokinase for a few patients. One or two patients, we got good results. I don't know whether it was because of that or something else. But yes.
Due to time factor, let me come to closure due to time factor. One last question I would like to ask Dr. Prakash Shigedar is, my friends who are running small hospitals, because MOA works for all orthopedic surgeons in periphery. So at periphery, if Prakash, you have to unmute yourself before answering. Probably you are muted. Yeah. So Prakash, what is your advice to my colleagues who are running small hospitals in periphery? When they should start, what precautions they should take, and how they should go about starting the surgeries, and when?
If they are having individual or small hospitals, and we cannot postpone the trauma surgeries especially, because trauma most of the times is emergency. We have to go with that. And only thing is that we can take the utmost precautions while doing the surgeries, and we can do at least what 5 things I have told, like get RT-PCR done, give personal protection kits to everybody, and take as most of the precautions as possible, and you have to work, because trauma you cannot postpone. If it is a displaced fracture, if it is a bleeding, if it is a something, when there is an elective surgery, then we can think of postponing for some time. But if it is an emergency, you have to go ahead with taking utmost precautions and following the guidelines, at least doing RT-PCR, taking proper precautions and minimizing the OT stop, etc. We have to work. There is no alternative. We cannot stop working.
I request our president, Dr. Ajit Shinde, sir, to conclude, have concluding remarks about today's seminar.
It was a wonderful experience. In last 6 episodes, today's episode is something different and talkative, interactive. There are still many questions I want to ask to Sanjay, that I will ask online, but definitely you people have given us very good knowledge and information regarding the how to run the hospital with protocol, or what are the challenges of the COVID hospital. The last question which Deshpande asked to Shigedar, what I suggest in the small places where the small hospitals are there, I think it is better they should adapt the policy of Deshpande sir and have all come together and one center where they will go and do the only COVID things. And for their routine non-COVID patient, they should do limited work in their hospital. Because it is very difficult, even a normal patient, once you give anesthesia and he go in hypoxia, and if he is not responding, many times this thing happens, because we rely on that test. 50% tests are or 60% tests are reliable, and we are very in a funky position, because unless and until oxygenation is good, we can't go ahead for surgery. That type of patient, again, we have to keep an ICU. In such a setup, if you are not in your hospital, that ICU, we should accept such type of patient. It is not clear that this patient might be having window period corona. So where is to go? And if you want to send to somebody else, automatically everybody will tell there is no place. All beds are full. So it is better they should adapt the policy. The clean cases they should do, and for all of them should have a common center.
Thank you, Dr. Ajit Shinde, sir. As a president, you have given a masterly advice to all your followers. Thank you, Dr. Prakash Shigedar, for excellent guidance about COVID surgery, whether a nightmare, and hats off and 3 cheers for Dr. Sanjay Durzad, who has really shown courage, and he is a true warrior. I also take this opportunity to thank Dr. Mangala Borkar, Professor
of medicine, Aurangabad Medical College. I also thank Dr. Ashok Shyam for a wonderful coverage and live Furka telecast on Ortho TV. I thank Dr. Parag Sancheti. I thank every MOA member. And I thank you all for giving me an opportunity to conduct this program. Thank you very much. Thereby we conclude and we are ready to leave. Thank you very much.
Now we will change name of Sanjay as a Bajigar.
Bajigar. Tanaji Balu Sare.
Yes.
Okay, we leave here.
Bye.
Yes. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
प्रकाश श्याम असेल तर विचारा उद्याचं काय काय.